Great. Let's get started. Welcome everyone to our session today, and thank you very much for attending. I am Apurva Kumar, and with me is Adam Bauer. We are security researchers on Lookout's threat intelligence team. We spend most of our time hunting and tracking mobile-focused malware threats. And today we're very excited to bring to you our latest public finding on Monokle. You might have heard of it. We released a report in July 2019, which is publicly available. So if you want to go read that after the session, it's on Lookout's blog. If you enjoy this talk and are a fan, we've got Monokle stickers hanging around, so come see us or go visit our booth, and that'd be a great addition. So just to let you know about where we're taking this session, Adam's going to start off by giving you a brief overview, exactly what Monokle is and why you should care about threats like that. He'll also talk about targeting and where we think Monokle is being used at the moment. And then I'll jump in and give you a bit of background on a Russian defense contractor called the Special Technology Center, and what we think it has to do with Monokle, and what we did in our investigation to find that connection between Monokle and the STC. And then Adam's going to wrap up by giving you a little conclusion about what you can do to protect yourself against threats like Monokle, and also what Monokle says about Android surveillanceware trends in general. So with that, I'll throw it over to Adam to get started.
Thank you. So before we get into looking at the implementation, I'd like to talk a little bit at a high level about what Monokle is, who STC are, and how this talk might be relevant to you. So firstly, Monokle is a professionally developed piece of mobile surveillanceware that's tied to a Russian defense contractor. It targets Android, and we have some evidence that there's an iOS component as well. Monokle uses some novel techniques to exfiltrate data, but it also follows some trends that we've seen in the surveillanceware industry that we're going to explore in some more detail. It, in general, is a pretty good representation of what professional app-based surveillanceware looks like. The Russian defense contractor in question is STC. They were hit by sanctions in 2016 for providing material support to the GRU in connection with US presidential election interference. We have strong evidence that ties them to the development of a suite of both offensive and defensive Android security software, which includes Monokle as the offensive component. Now, Monokle is a targeted threat that's likely to be deployed against specific groups and individuals, so it may not be a direct threat to everyone in this room. This is something I wanted to show you. This is a map of mobile surveillanceware detections by country. This is all Lookout surveillanceware detections over the past year. And you can see that surveillanceware in general affects a broad number of countries and a broad number of individuals. And Monokle is just a piece of a much larger ecosystem of malware. And it's certainly an example of something to be concerned about. So let's take a closer look at the malware itself. The first question you might be asking is, why is it called Monokle? And the reason that is because we have some evidence that that's likely the name of the malware. So many of the Monokle samples bundle an open source library. And the open source library uses some C preprocessor macros that generate strings, which show the build path where the application was built. And we can see it's built in a directory called monokle-agent, and then a subdirectory called android-agent. So we suspect this to either be a product name or a code name. We also believe that Monokle's been under development since roughly 2015 at the earliest, or at the latest. And the reason we believe this is based on package signing dates. So a package signing date is metadata, which can be forged, but we believe these to be accurate in the case of Monokle because of consistency in two ways. The first is that older samples tend to be less sophisticated than newer samples. And we can see that the Monokle code base actually underwent some pretty substantial refactorings, so it's relatively easy to date those. In addition to that, signing dates are always before we were able to get access to an app, so it looks like an app was built, and then we were able to ingest it at some point in the future. In terms of the applications themselves, Monokle pretends to be a number of fairly popular general interest type apps, and those would include things like Skype, and those would appeal to like a broad range of users. But there's a smaller set of apps that would only seem to target specific groups. And those would include people who are interested in Islam, people associated with the Ahrar al-Sham militant group in Syria, people living in or associated with the Caucasus region of Eastern Europe, and also people who would be interested in a messaging application called UzbekChat. Now, in addition to what the apps pretend to be, we also have detected installations in the wild, and those are in Cuba, Turkey, and Algeria. So we know this is being actively deployed. Monokle includes pretty extensive surveillanceware capabilities that would be consistent with other surveillanceware we've seen. These would be things like audio and video surveillance, the ability to exfiltrate data from different types of social media apps. Before we look at some of the more novel capabilities, I wanted to talk a little bit about how most surveillanceware implements sort of standard surveillance functionality. Almost all Android surveillanceware uses standard APIs for doing things like capturing text messages, contacts, call logs, browser history, photos and recording. So, these are documented APIs that serve a purpose for legitimate apps, but can also be misused in various ways. The code you're seeing on the screen there is the SMS data exfiltration code that Monokle uses. You can see they use the SMS content provider for Android, and they use that to parse data for text messages and exfiltrate them to a C2. The only slightly sophisticated feature Monokle has for something like this is they have various configurable filters that they can use to filter data by, for example, certain keywords. So that's potentially useful in like a large surveillance campaign. Second most popular method to exfiltrate data is directly accessing an application's private data files. This is an example for the Samsung browser that Monokle uses. And you can see this is as easy as accessing a SQLite database and running a SQL query, with the only caveat being that it requires root. So we haven't seen Monokle deployed using exploits, but we know there are scenarios where it would need to be deployed with root access. There are a number of different features that would require root on a device, so they wouldn't be implemented for no reason. Now, we have seen that the app file is a trend we've seen in the past couple of years, and this is where it tries to be as functional as possible without requiring root access. One of the means the authors are using to do this is misuse of accessibility services. How Monokle works here is it acts basically like a screen reader. It looks for different elements on the screen when certain applications are in use, pulls text from them, and then exfiltrates those to a C2. And it's actually the most extensive use of accessibility services that we've seen up to this point. But we have seen other surveillanceware applications starting to do things along these lines. Historically, Android phones have been easier to root than they have been today. It used to be that most malware would just root a device. That's no longer the case. Android security continues to improve. So threat actors are finding new ways to get data to still be useful. And now we get to look at some of the more novel features of Monokle. And this is one. This is screen unlock recording. What happens here is Android sends some broadcast actions when the screen turns on and becomes active. And it also sends a broadcast action when the device is unlocked. So what the Monokle authors do here is they start recording the screen when the screen turns on after it's been off. Then if the user unlocks the device successfully, they'll save a video recording of the operation and upload it to their C2. If the device isn't unlocked, then they just discard the recording. And I actually have an example of one of those recordings here. So you can see that's quite an effective way to get something like a PIN or a password used to unlock a device. There's a couple of reasons why you'd want to do this. The first one is if you expect to have physical access to a device, you can obviously unlock it easily. The second one would be users tend to reuse things like PINs and passcodes, so you could potentially use one that you know for other services. Next, we've also found that Monokle manipulates the trusted certificate store on Android. So what that would imply is that they have the ability, or intend to have the ability, to perform man-in-the-middle attacks against TLS traffic. That's really why you would add a certificate to that store. Next is use of the exposed framework. So exposed is an open source framework that facilitates intercepting method calls. Monokle uses it to do some hooking to appear invisible to process manager. This is another one of those capabilities that requires root access. But we haven't seen use of exposed very often in production surveillanceware. In addition, Monokle tracks frequently used words through exfiltrating data from the predictive text input dictionary on Android. So you can use this to find frequently used words that a user might use in conversation. Now I'd like to talk a little bit about the communication protocol Monokle uses. There are two control channels and some variations on how the communication can work. I'm going to talk about the most recent samples in terms of what the traffic flow looks like. And how it works is the Monokle agent opens a TLS connection to a remote C2, and over that connection, it'll send an agent registration object. Server will respond back with an AES encrypted server command object, and it's AES encrypted over TLS. And then the agent will respond back with an agent response object. There is another method of TCP communication which can be configured, and that uses the same traffic flow, but it's tunneled over email, so SMTP and POP3 over TLS. Second communication channel is SMS, and there's two ways that this can work. The first is through the use of these control phrases that look like this. So these are innocuous seeming text messages that trigger the Monokle agent to perform specific actions. In addition to that, there's a second method of SMS control. And the second method uses base64 encoded server command objects embedded inside specifically formatted URLs. And the agent can parse those and again perform data exfiltration operations. Now the outbound for SMS control is always through TCP. So there is always TCP communication happening if data is being exfiltrated. In terms of how the communication works, Monokle uses a protocol and an interface definition language called Thrift. An IDL is a language that's used to describe an API. So some that you might be familiar with, if you're not familiar with Apache Thrift, would be like WSDL for SOAP web services or MIDL for COM objects. So it's just the Thrift tool set can take interface descriptions and generate client code for them. And that looks like this. This is an example of me just generating some client code in Java for a simple Thrift service. And that brings us nicely to the evidence that we have for iOS components. What we've found is that there are a number of generated Java classes that seem to be intended to transport iOS-specific data. Here's one. This appears to be consistent with a class designed to carry data for an Apple keychain password item. Then we have another one that seems to be designed to carry health kit characteristic data that would be of the type that you would get from HK Health Store on iOS. And here's another one that transports a bundle ID, device token, and team ID, and it's called APNS registration. APNS is Apple Push Notification Service. That's roughly the data you would need to configure it. We've seen iOS surveillanceware before using APNS to control different types of surveillance functionality. So ultimately, we believe that the thrift tool set was used to generate client code for these classes that don't serve any purpose on Android, but were bundled in the application, likely unintentionally. There's no real reason for developers to spend time designing services that they don't intend to use. So it's fairly likely there is an iOS component that we haven't seen, either under development or actually being deployed. Now I'm going to turn things back over to Apurva, and she's going to talk a little bit about the connections between SDC and Monokle malware.
Okay, thanks, Adam. Okay, so now on to the boring stuff, attribution, right? So to start off the section, I'm going to give you a little bit of background on the STC and or the Special Technology Center. And you may have heard of that name before. If it rings a bell, in 2016, the Obama administration sanctioned 9 Russian entities for election interference in the US presidential elections. And STC was actually one of 3 companies specifically called out in that executive order for providing material support to the GRU. Now, that year was a particularly slow news cycle, right? So you remember all of these details. They actually specifically mention which special technology center they're talking about. They call it the Special Technology Center, or the STC, or the STLC. They give you an address in St. Petersburg, and they also give you a website, stc-spb.ru. Now, that's important for later on. But if you actually go to that website, this is what you see. The STC is, in fact, a Russian defense contractor. It was founded in 2000, around 2000, 2001, and it's based out of St. Petersburg. And we know that because of lots of online sources of information, as well as a documentary produced by a Russian state-owned channel, Zvezda. They did a whole documentary on the Special Technology Center, and they talk about one of their most popular products. This is what it is. It's a drone. It's an Orlan 10 drone. So it's really popular for producing radio frequency equipment and unmanned aerial vehicles, as they call them. The documentary goes on to describe the assembly line, the fact that their main customer is the Russian military, that they produce about 200 or 300 of these a year. And also the training facilities just outside St. Petersburg. So to get an idea of what this company actually does, the website explains quite the same thing. Now, this is a literal Russian translation of the website, so it's quite poor. But what the entire website describes is exactly that. So unmanned aerial vehicles, radio-controlled equipment, radar systems. But what I want to point out is that it never really mentions any sort of software development or indeed any Android or iOS development. So the website we found was actually last updated in 2014. So maybe they haven't updated it just yet with their more recent things. So what we've actually found is a strong connection that the STC has a pretty advanced and pretty good Android development pipeline, and probably an iOS one as well. And what I'm going to do over the next few slides is kind of give you an idea of how we got to that conclusion through our investigation. So the first piece of evidence I want you to look at is a set of applications, or Android applications, that were signed by the same signing certificate. Now, if you don't know what a signing certificate is, Android applications are required to be signed with a signing certificate before they're successfully deployed on an Android device. So if an application is signed with a particular signing certificate, it means that it's probably connected to the same developer or the same development entity. This is all security stuff. So you kind of want to make sure that those set of applications have the same origin. That's important to understand. So all of these applications that you see here are signed with the same signing certificate. There's one that's of interest, and that's the one that's highlighted there. It's called Security Update Service. That's a sample of Monokle. So when we started our investigation, we had a handful of Monokle samples, and we started searching around similar applications that may have been signed with the same certificate. What's interesting about this one is that that's a sample of Monokle, but none of the others are. And so that stuck out to us as something interesting, and we started digging into the other applications. So you see something like App Control, Defender, Pathfinder, NetMonitor. And what it actually turns out is Defender, Pathfinder, and NetMonitor are a suite of defensive security applications. Defender is actually an antivirus solution, so one that any company would end up buying to protect their endpoints. And all of these share a certificate with the Monokle sample. So that was really interesting. And I just want to highlight that one, Defender and App Control, because we're going to take a closer look at those two. So this is what Defender looks like if you install it on your device. It's an antivirus software for Android. And on the right-hand side, it might not be as clear as I think it is, but it really just references STC. And you can see the same link to the website, stc-spb.ru. So logically, this was our first clue to think, well, OK, maybe this is connected to this particular Russian defense contractor. But when you do attribution's a bit hard, right? You see one link like this, and you think, OK, well, I'd like to confirm. I'd like to have a couple of data points that I can actually really, with confidence, say that this is the connection. And if you're an Android developer, you would tell me, well, I can just create a screen like that and slap on a URL and claim that it's from the STC, and it doesn't really matter. And so that sort of skepticism was something that we also took into account. So we went and looked at a couple of other certificates. These are another bunch of applications signed with another signing certificate, so connected together in terms of a development or a program or a developer. And you can see Defender and Defender UI there, so we started deeper diving into Defender. And the rest of the applications are sort of test applications. So you can see Java test there, and the Defender applications are sort of newer and older beta versions and things like that. But again, one of them stuck out to us. And no prizes for guessing the one that we've blurred out a little bit. So Task Edge stuck out because it's distinctly different from all the other applications. It's actually an application specifically for Samsung devices. Task Edge is a utility and productivity tool that you can use on those Samsung devices that have the curved edges. So it's really just something like that. It's actually pretty well developed, and it even has its own website. It was recently in the Samsung Galaxy App Store until recently, but I think it hasn't been updated up to the real version. What's interesting about it, I should point out, it's not malware. So none of those applications were actually malware. It was Defender, and it was a couple of other applications. So this one is not malware. I just want to make clear. Similarly, on this website, you can actually go to a contacts page, and it lists the author of the program, as well as like a few handles and email addresses that we were able to connect to a little bit of an online presence. So we started digging around that particular email and those handles, and we ended up with getting to a LinkedIn profile of a pretty seasoned Android software developer. Now, this guy's pretty good at his job. He's been doing Android development for quite some time. He worked at the STC, or he claims to have worked at the STC between September 2017 and August 2018. And he also claims on his LinkedIn profile to be the team lead of a Defender antivirus project and other applications for a government customer. So this is an interesting point to make, in that it linked straight back to STC again. And now you might say, well, anybody can make a LinkedIn profile and put up a couple of things. And so we did a little bit of digging, and we used web archive tools like Wayback Machine. And we went back through this person's history, and it looks like both the developer and his experience has been building up over time. He has a significant online presence. So it appears to be that this person, we really don't have any reason to believe that this is a fake persona. He's been around for quite some time. He's been building up his skills. He's been building up some things. So this was our second sort of confirmation or a consensus on that topic. Now let's switch over and look at the App Control app. So remember, there was those other defensive security applications and then something called App Control. If you install it on your device, this is what it looks like. And the interesting one that you want to pay attention to is the leftmost screenshot. And that kind of shows you that there's a possibility to enable and disable the other applications like NetMonitor, Pathfinder, Defender. Now, they're grayed out here because we probably didn't have those installed on the same device when we were playing around with this software. But you can basically do other stuff like change passwords and look at event logs and things like that. So it's a general settings application or control application, as the name implies. It appears to interact with the other four. So they appear to be very strongly connected. So at this point, this is what we're seeing, right? The STC is definitely producing something called Defender. And Defender plus Pathfinder plus NetMonitor can all be controlled and interacted with using a control application called AppControl. And we also believe, given some of the information that we have, that the STC also produces Monokle. But we want to look for more information. So when we dug deeper into the AppControl app, we actually found programmatically that it can also interact with Monokle. In fact, it interacts with Monokle under certain circumstances. So technically, if you have the right sample of Monokle on your device, as well as the right sample of AppControl, it can enable and disable Monokle surveillance activity whenever it desires or under certain conditions, or perhaps through attacker messages. And so that's interesting, and that tied all of these applications together. If that wasn't enough, we obviously looked further, and we found that certain samples of Monokle and certain samples of Defender actually shared C2 infrastructure, which is a pretty big connection and a pretty obvious one. Perhaps it's shared infrastructure. Perhaps that IP address is being used by a couple of people. What we also noticed was even if the IP address was different sometimes, they also shared the same SSL certificate on all those servers. So it was kind of pretty definitive that all of these applications are really just connected to each other and have the same development team. But that's the applications, right? Let's take a look further into the STC. So we went and did a bit of digging around on local job search websites in the St. Petersburg area. It turns out the STC is actually hiring for Android developers and iOS developers, and that's a pretty good indication of the skills that they require for their services. In January 2020, they actually had 83 open positions on a single website, and some of them were quite related to the development of Monokle, such as this one that I want to highlight here. It's a researcher or developer position for Android or iOS. And the interesting part of it is that they want somebody with experience in reverse engineering. They're also looking for, and that's the second last line there on the screen, somebody who can analyze and understand the internal architecture of Android and iOS. So this is starting to get a little bit deeper than just development. And if you go back into the requirements, you'll see that they're also looking for somebody who understands and uses the tool IDA, which is a popular reverse engineering tool. Under the plus section, the fourth line there says they're looking for somebody with development or reverse experience for jailbreak iOS. So this suggests to us that possibly they're looking for either they're either interested in or looking for development of a jailbreak, specifically for iOS, which probably means they're developing something for iOS as well. The most interesting part of this job application for me was the fact that the STC employees have better perks than I do. They have 28 days with leave. So I need to get that. So what do we know so far? Monokle is a professionally developed Android surveillanceware made for government customers. We know that it is it's able to work in a variety of situations, rooted or not rooted, in every possible way that it can. It has multiple lines of communication with its attackers and controllers. We also know that it shares signing certificates and C2 infrastructure with Defender and AppControl and Pathfinder and a couple of other defensive security suite of applications. But not only that, also that AppControl interacts both with Defender on the UI side as well as programmatically with Monokle on the inside. And so that links these three together as well. If you take a look at their code, there's actually similarities in code implementation as well. So to a person who looks at code all the time, if you have that much similarity, it's either the same development team creating it, or it's the case that the source of the code is the same. They could have copied it from somewhere, but most likely the development team is probably the same. Now on the STC side, we know from the job postings, sorry, for the LinkedIn profile of the former employee, as well as the URL that we saw in that about page for Defender, that they are developing something called Defender, and it is an antivirus, and it's consistent with what we see. Also, other open source intelligence information, as well as job postings, indicate that the STC produces Android software and probably also iOS. So those are a summary of how we got to that connection and how we were able to link the STC's development programs with Monokle, the surveillanceware that we found. So I'm going to throw it over, back over to Adam. He's going to wrap up and tell you how you can defend yourself against Monokle and other threats like it, and what that says about Android surveillanceware trends.
All right, so the first thing we'll talk about is detection. Now, Lookout's released 80 different IOCs for Monokle. That includes hashes for all the Android applications that we've seen so far, in addition to a YARA rule and all the IP addresses and domains we've seen the applications communicating with. So you really have two options for detection. The first one is endpoint security. I think with hashes being released and with this being in the news, most endpoint security solutions would be likely to detect like the known samples. Security solutions would really differentiate themselves in terms of whether or not they can detect things that, haven't been seen before or haven't been included in the report. Obviously, network security type devices can detect communication to like the known bad IP addresses and domains. There might be some types of like network security analytics you could do that would detect like the beaconing behavior, even though it's all going to be over TLS. Some of the Monokle samples send TLS traffic over ports that might be unusual in most people's environment. So that's a possibility as well. One of the big issues with mobile clients is they're not always connected to a network that most people would have any control over. So it's potentially difficult to detect that way. In terms of remediation and any forensic options, the situation is not good. There is logging in some of the Monokle samples. It's always disabled. We think it's used for development purposes. Most samples don't have any logging compiled in at all. So there's not like a log you can go through to see like what data may have been exfiltrated at what time or anything like that. It also uses good encryption, right? It uses TLS with certificate pinning. So you can't do TLS interception and inspect traffic that way. It's likely that you could probably find one Monokle was deployed on a device, but after that point, you potentially have to consider anything on the device as potentially compromised. There is one possibility for network traffic analytics, and that's the email communication protocol. So if you had like a setup where you do TLS interception and bulk capture traffic, I think you could probably write a parser for that email communication. You'd have to get a sample of the app to get the AES key that's being used, but would be feasible. Obviously, that's going to be a small part of potential activity. The other issue there, too, is that the email communication protocol doesn't seem to be super common, in that mostly we see apps configured just to use SSL socket. In terms of trends, I'd like to call out, there's a few trends that Monokle is really following. The first is functionality without root access. I talked about this a little bit before, but it's something we're seeing more and more, really. So the issue is that root exploits tend to be fairly device specific most of the time. and tend to be expensive, and Android security is improving a lot. So it's very difficult for someone authoring a surveillanceware application to make guarantees about whether or not you can root a particular target's device. So in response, the authors of these sorts of applications have been taking steps to increase the functionality they can provide without rooting. And misuse of accessibility services is one example of that. The other trend we've been seeing is, in the past, it used to be the case that either surveillanceware didn't use good encryption for its C2 communication. It was fairly common to see either no encryption or somebody using like single byte XOR, which you can just brute force. There's only 256 keys. Well, 255. Or for more sophisticated things, you might see like use of AES with a hard-coded key, where if you had the app sample, you could write parsers for traffic. That's no longer really true. Most malware these days is using TLS and often using certificate pinning for some of the more sophisticated ones. And that's really probably driven by an increasing awareness of network traffic forensic techniques. And the final trend I will call out is that there seems to be a great deal of demand for these types of tools on mobile. We continue to discover new families extremely regularly. And we continue to see older families used in new campaigns. So the number of these tools that are available is only increasing. With that, we're going to turn it over to questions.
How are you getting your samples?
I don't know if we can share all the sources we ingest samples from, so I'm not sure I'm the best one to answer that one. Go ahead.
You mentioned the iOS APNS. If I understood correctly, you're saying, okay, for a mobile application, they were leveraging that because it was not otherwise being leveraged for a legitimate purpose. Did I characterize that properly?
No, so let me clarify with that a little bit. There's code inside the Android samples that really only serves a purpose on iOS. The code is never called in Android. It wouldn't serve a purpose on Android. It's just bundled into the apps. And the reason why we think it's bundled into the apps is because it was generated with a tool based off an interface definition where the interface would be for iOS and for Android. So it's basically shared code between iOS and Android clients, sort of like a web service, for example, where you might have generated code to call a web service that wouldn't serve any purpose in your client application. APNS specifically, like we've seen push notifications used on iOS to control malware. It has legitimate purposes. I mean, it's an Apple product. But since it's included in malware and in generated code that's for a service that malware uses, it's probably used for something malicious. Go ahead. So you're wondering if, let me see if I've got this right, you're wondering if the malware will prompt the user to like enable access to contacts and things like this?
Media projection APIs in order to record the screen, if it is, it was not using the root permissions.
It was for screen recording, it does use root permissions. It's required. That's how you're able to get that recording, yes. And this is one of the reasons why, I mean, like there's has to be deployment scenarios where it's deployed with a root exploit. We just haven't seen that. Go ahead.
Did you explore the C2 servers in some way, and where were they running?
Most of the C2 servers were like hosting services, like web hosting services. They weren't on corporate networks as a rule. We did explore them a fair bit. we weren't able to get access to like any type of data exfil or anything of that nature, if that's what you're wondering about. Anyone else? All right, well, thank you very much.